of large eyes with right larger than left, watering redness intermittently. There is no history of blurring of vision, double vision in any case, diurnal variation, no history of variation on fatigue or rest. There is no history of pain or recurrent swelling. There is no history of any ocular surgery.
Next page, Ashish.
I have shifted to the next
page. There is a past ocular history of redness 18 months back, for which patient took injection for a few months. Exact history and the reports not available. There is a past medical history. It's a known case of hyperthyroidism under oral tablet. Treatment since 4 years. Surgical history is not significant. Past family ocular history, family history of parents suffering diabetes and thyroid disease, social history, addicted to alcohol and the smoking, 5 to 8 cigarette smokes per day, no other addiction. On examination, the patient is well oriented in time, place and person. The systemic examination within normal limit, head posture is straight. No chin elevation or the head tilt. On ocular examination, there is a bilateral symmetrical proptosis with the conjunctival hyperemia, and there is a scleral show.
May I go to the next slide, Nisha?
Yes.
Okay.
On clinical examination, the right eye unaided visual acuity 6/18. The best corrected visual acuity 6/6. The right eye lids were elevated with 2 mm superior and 2 mm inferior scleral show. Conjunctiva, there is a mild congestion at the limbus. Cornea is clear, iris normal pattern, anterior chamber is deep, pupil rounded, reacting to light, lens is clear and fundus within normal limit. Left eye examination, unaided visual acuity 6/24, the best corrected visual acuity is 6/6, lids there is a elevation with 2 mm superior and 2 mm inferior scleral show. There is a mild congestion of the conjunctiva at the limbus, cornea is clear, iris pattern normal. Anterior chamber normal depth, pupil round, reacting to light, lens clear, fundus within normal limit. Examination of the right eye, vertical palpable aperture is 15 mm. There is no diplopia. Proptosis is 3 mm in the right eye and the 2 mm in the left eye. Bell's phenomena is good. Extraocular movements of full and the free in the both eye. Corneal sensation normal in the right and left eye.
So, professor, we are done with the case. Yeah. I think we can start the primer with Bamel Roy, sir.
Okay. Karugi, ma'am, shall we start with the questions?
Yeah, sure, sure. No problems.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, Nisha?
Yes, ma'am.
Good presentation. And I just wanted to ask you, just demonstrate how you have taken the measurement of the proptosis.
Measurement of the, it is done with the, on Nafazaghi's method by standing behind the patient and elevating the chin of the patient. It is measured with the scale. The one end is kept at the lateral margin of the lateral orbital margin and other scale at the apex of the cornea. If it is more than 18 mm, then this proptosis.
Okay. So your readings were around 20 and 21?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Are there any other methods by which you can measure it in on an outpatient basis?
Yes, ma'am. There is a method exophthalmometer. Hertel exophthalmometer.
Okay.
And the Leeds scale, transparent yes. scale.
Isha, yes. you can on your video now.
And how do you use the Leeds scale?
The lateral, the one end is kept at the lateral orbital rim, and the other is at the corneal apex.
Okay.
If the reading is more than 15 mm, then there is a proptosis.
Okay. Okay, Nisha, now the thing is that this is obviously a case of thyroid ophthalmopathy. So this is an exophthalmos, but how would you differentiate where you don't know there is a thyroid from a case of pseudo exophthalmos and from a patient of proptosis from an exophthalmos? How would you differentiate, you know?
There is a other signs of the thyroiditis, like the systemic. There is a weight loss with the good appetite, palpitation, and irritability. Cardiac signs like the sinus tachycardia and the arrhythmia. Pre-tibial mixed edema and thyroid acropathy, like the clubbing of fingers. And other ocular signs like the lid retraction.
Stick to the findings in your case. That will be better. You're right. Lid retraction. Yeah.
Go ahead. Doing well.
Lid retraction.
Yes.
And scleral show.
Very good.
Staring and the frightened look.
Yeah. What is the name? Means you can tell the name also.
Poachers. Name? Poachers and.
No. What is dalrymple sign?
Dalrymple sign is the lid retraction in the primary case.
And your patient also has bulbar congestion, right? Bulbar conjunctiva
phimosis. Yes,
is there a name ascribable to that kind of a sign? It's called Golden Zyha sign, okay?
Okay.
So, what I wanted to ask you is that which of the, when you see the, this, which is the muscle which is first affected in a thyroid ophthalmopathy? And which is next and which is next?
First is the inferior rectus.
Very good.
Then next is the medial rectus.
Right.
And then next superior rectus and then lateral rectus.
Very good. And what do you would prefer to do? Would you prefer to do a CAT scan or an MRI for this patient?
I would like to do the CAT scan in the patient.
And why do you say so?
Because involvement of the, to see the involvement of optic nerve.
Okay. And?
And any space occupant lesion.
Okay. And what would your treatment be in these cases? Would you prefer to use steroids or would you prefer to use something else?
First of all, symptomatic treatment like the lubricating eye drops and lid taping if there is a lag of thalmos, topical NSAID, and can use systemic steroids.
How much would be your dosage?
Prednisolone 60 to 80 milligram per day.
Okay. And suppose a patient is a diabetic and intolerant to steroids, are there any other forms of therapy which are known?
Yes, ma'am. Like the orbital steroid injection can be given.
What else?
Else radiotherapy combined with immunosuppressant like the azathioprine.
Okay. Which are the other immunosuppressants which you can give?
Monoclonal antibody inhibitor like the rituximab.
Very good. And what else? There are a few others also.
azathioprine.
Yes. And? Would you consider cyclosporin or?
Yes, ma'am.
Or methotrexate?
Yes, ma'am, can be given.
Yeah, and do you happen to know what are the dosages for this?
No, ma'am, I don't know.
Okay. Cyclosporin is given in 2 doses per day, whereas the methotrexate is 2 to 5 milligrams, which is given once a week. Okay. And do you know of some other newer compounds which are there, which immunomodulators which can be given apart from the rituximab?
No, ma'am.
There is something called as tocilizumab, and there is etanercept, you know, which can be given also. So these are the alternatives to your treatment in case you can't give steroids, you know. Now, is there any specific antioxidants that you would like to give in these patients?
Vitamin E can.
Have you heard of something called as selenium? Selenium in a dosage of 100 milligrams can be given. It's a good antioxidant, you know, to be given. And what are your, how would you differentiate between an active and an inactive thyroid disease?
There is a inactive disease. There is a conjunctival hyperemia, soft tissue involvement like the lid swelling, lid hyperemia, corneal involvement like the superior limbic keratoconjunctivitis and the punctate epithelial erosion.
Okay. I can't hear her.
Can be present in the act.
Can you repeat the last part? I couldn't hear you.
Corneal involvement like the superior limbic keratoconjunctivitis and the corneal punctate epithelial erosion.
Okay. And what would constitute as an emergency in a thyroid eye disease?
If the central vision is diminished, it indicates the involvement of the optic nerve.
What else?
Color sensitivity.
No, that wouldn't constitute an emergency, no? See, the eyeball is big, it's proptosed, so what can happen?
It can lead to the muscle fibrosis and restriction of the extraocular movement and causes diplopia.
Before that, wouldn't you get an exposure keratitis? Exposure.
Yes, ma'am.
Vision threatening complications,
yes. No, from this.
Yes, ma'am.
Corneal opacification, exposure, it could be lead to perforations. Okay. And what else could be threatening apart from the optic nerve compressions also would be threatening, no? Because that can compromise the optic nerve. And this, how would you deal with it? I mean, when would you suggest an optical orbital decompression?
When there is a diminished in the vision and the color sensitivity.
Acute, sharp or slow onset?
Slow onset, ma'am. In the acute stage, we cannot do the decompression in the fibrotic later stages after 6 months of the resolution of the congestive stage.
Okay. So, I think I'm through with my questions. Swapnish?
Yeah, Nisha, I have simple questions for you. What is the volume of orbit?
Volume of the orbit is the 20 to 20 ml.
30 ml. Okay, and how do you define in measurement what is enophthalmos and what is proptosis?
Proptosis is the protrusion of the forward protrusion of.
Quantify. In, suppose you measure.
If you are measuring on an exophthalmometer, for example, how much will be the readings? That's what he's asking.
If it is more than 18 mm, then it it is proptosis. And if it is less than 15 mm, then...
Can it be asymmetrical also?
Yes, sir, can be.
So what is that value of asymmetry for it to be...
If it is less than 2 mm in the both the eyes.
Less than or more than? More than.
Nee, if it is more than 2 mm, then it is significant. Yes. If it is less than, then it is relative.
Rohit, correct me if I am wrong. Is proptosis more than 21 and enophthalmos less than 12 mm? Are those the values? Because I think that is
what I know. 12 or 13?
Yeah, yeah. I guess 13. I guess
13. Yeah. I think it is.
Yeah. Yes. So we have 5-6 minutes more.
Can I ask few questions, sir, if with the permission of examiners?
Yes. We have oculoplasty.
Please go ahead.
Okay. Nisha, like madam said, what treatment can you give? Just tell me what first thing that you will advise to this patient before starting the treatment. That was very much highlighted in your history that you told us.
Like the thyroid profile, to go for thyroid profile, pre-TSH level and pre-3 and 3-4 level.
Okay, and as per his habits, what will you tell him to change?
So, smoking, to stop the smoking. It increases the risk of the thyroid eye disease.
Yeah, so both. It increases the recurrence and even the makes the disease more grave. So you will tell him to stop smoking. That is the most important thing that you will tell him. Second, you said you will give steroids to the patient. First, tell me, how do you actually define that disease is active or not? Like this patient sits in front of you. What will tell you that the disease is active? What is that score called?
The score is the European Graves ophthalmoscopy score, UGOGO score.
Okay, anything else?
Wagner-Swan.
Werner's clinical activity score and visa classification, correct? And
yes.
UGOGO.
Yes, sir.
So clinically we use visa and clinical activity score more. So can you tell me the 7 points that you should see in clinical activity scores?
First is the spontaneous orbital pain. Second is the gaze yoke orbital pain.
Okay.
Third is the lead edema. Fourth is the hyperemia of the lead. Fifth is the conjunctival congestion. Sixth is the chemosis. And seven is the hyperemia of the carnucle and the plaque.
Very good.
So if you find the patient is active with the score of more than like 7 or so, that patient is found to be active disease. Okay, so you generally give him steroids. So what is the steroid that is preferred?
IV methylprednisolone can be given 1 gram per day for.
Okay, so can you tell me what is the exact mechanism for which we use methylprednisolone in such autoimmune or inflammatory diseases?
There is a proliferation of the orbital fibroblasts secondary to the increased level of the antibody, which causes hyperemia and the infiltration of the muscle.
Infiltration of muscle is with what? Other than fibroblasts, what is the other material?
Interstitial tissue.
No, the name of that interstitial tissue.
Something that is very much water loving, likes to drink water.
Osmotic imbibition of the water and the increased secretion of glycosa, minoglycosa.
Yes, very good.
So that is what there and see.
Last minute.
Yeah, so the steroids, your oral steroids do work, but you are, when we give methylprednisolone, it basically goes and works at the cellular levels and it kills those neutrophils which are very active in inflammatory disease. So whenever you give your IVMP, it kills around 50 to 60% of those active neutrophils and thus reduces the inflammation. So we prefer giving IVMP in such cases. Okay, so suppose this patient is now been treated for 1 year and do you think the disease is active or inactive in this case?
It is inactive in this
case. Okay, perfect. That is inactive. If he comes and requests you that, please, my lid is very much exposing my eye. Can you do a surgery for me? Will you do it?
Yes, we can go for lid surgery.
No, which surgery first you?
First is the Mullerotomy.
Directly for lid surgery will go or something else?
No, first we do the compression, decompression surgery.
Okay. Then?
Then a recession of the rectus muscle.
Was time up?
Okay, fine, fine.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Well done, Nisha.
Karobi,
well
madam.
Done, Nisha.
Can we start
Thank
the second
you,
case?
Yes, of course.
Okay. Are you sharing or should I share?
No, no, so Ashish, you share.
Okay, yes.
Also, there is something Coca-Cola sign in thyroid ophthalmopathy. Anybody knows about it? Anybody knows? Okay, that's a homework. Coca-Cola sign.
Coke bottle sign, I think it is.
Something like that. Something
Coke bottle sign.
Coke bottle sign.
And all those 35 signs, no, you don't need to remember. Just remember the most important ones.
Yeah.
I think Dr. Priyanka is going to present from Bombay Hospital.
Yeah, that's right. That's me, sir.
Yeah.
All right. Good evening, everyone. My case is of a 13-year-old who came with the chief complaints of decreased vision in both the eyes, with difficulty in seeing at night since 3 to 4 months. There was no history of redness, pain, photophobia, flashes or floaters. There was no history of trauma or surgery.
Ashish?
Yes, I have shifted. I think it's just taking some time. I'll stop my video. You have seen now?
Not yet, sir.
Will in a moment.
Yeah.
There, yeah.
Oh. It's stuck on the history.
Okay, yeah. I'll just stop share and I'll start the screen again.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Can you see it now?
Yes, I can.
Yeah.
Go on to the next.
Right.
I am on the past ocular history page. There's some issue.
Okay.
Can you see it now?
No, sir. It's still stuck on the first slide, actually.
Okay, should I try?
I think his net is bad.
How can you see?
No?
You have stopped sharing, sir?
It's come.
Yeah, now it's come.
Yeah.
Okay.
The past ocular history revealed that the patient was using glasses since 3 years. There was no history of any eye surgeries, amblyopia, strabismus, or eye trauma. Past medical history was not significant. The past family ocular history revealed that he has 2 elder siblings, none of which have similar complaints. The personal history is not significant.
I think so. So you can share the screen if the screen is not visible.
Yeah.
It's not changed. The slide's not changed yet.
No, not yet. So
okay, I'll stop my share, sir. So, yeah. Sir.
Sir, you'll have to share maybe.
Shall I continue, sir? Hello?
You see any slide prep?
Screen is not seen.
Yeah, I can. On examination, the patient was well-oriented in time, place, and person. The cardiovascular, respiratory, central nervous systems were within normal limits. The head posture of the patient was straight. There was no chin elevation or head tilt. On ocular examination, his uncorrected visual acuity in the right eye was 6/18. Best corrected visual acuity in the right eye was 6/6 with a -1.5 diopter sphere. The ocular adnexa, conjunctiva, sclera, cornea were normal. The anterior chamber was deep and quiet. The iris was normal. The pupil was normal in size and reacting to light. The lens and anterior vitreous were normal, clear. The left eye, also similar findings actually. So on posterior fundus examination using an indirect ophthalmoscopy with a 20 diopter lens, the right eye shows that the media were clear. The optic disc appears to be normal in size, shape, and configuration. The margins are distinct. There is an overall tessellated appearance to the fundus. Retinal arterioles are attenuated, and there is a blackish bony spicule type pigmentation which is seen in the mid peripheral retina, which is about two disc areas temporal to the macula temporally, and about one disc area nasal to the optic disc. In the left eye, there were similar findings. The optic nerve on the left, optic disc on the left, in the left eye shows mild pallor, but it's not very significant. And same, tessellated fundus and bony spicule changes, more or less similar changes. There is also a hemorrhage along the superior retinal arteriole, just close to the disc. So my diagnosis is bilateral typical retinitis pigmentosa with bilateral simple myopia.
Okay.
The fundus picture was not seen when she was, so just show it to everyone.
Yes, ma'am. Is it visible now, ma'am?
Yeah, it's visible now.
Okay.
Everybody could see the fundus picture?
Yes. Yeah, we can see it.
Okay, I think she has given out the diagnosis. We can move ahead with the viva. Dr. Rohit?
Ma'am, ma'am, please, you can continue.
No, you can ask her questions and I'll ask later. Don't worry. Go ahead.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, why do you say it is retinitis pigmentosa? What are the findings in your case?
Yeah, on clinical findings, they are very characteristic findings actually. There is spicule type pigmentation in the mid peripheral retina along with attenuation of the arterioles. So, and it's bilateral. So, that made me think clinically, based
and
on our clinical findings, that it is.
Classical triad of typical, you said typical RP.
Yeah.
So what is the classical triad seen in that?
The triad of typical retinitis pigmentosa is attenuated arterioles, a waxy disc pallor, and bony spicule type pigmentation in the mid peripheral retina.
So all findings are there in your case?
Yeah.
Okay. So what is what is retinitis pigmentosa?
Retinitis pigmentosa is an inherited group of disorders. Basically, they are retinal degenerations, which initially affect the rod receptors, followed by subsequent involvement in the cones as well. And they cause progressive visual field loss.
Okay. So your patient was having night blindness. So can
I'm
you
sorry.
Give us
yeah,
a differential?
Blindness.
Yeah, so a differential diagnosis of night blindness in a 13-year-old, can you just tell?
There can be xerophthalmia. One of the diagnoses could be xerophthalmia and choroideremia, congenital stationary night blindness, Leber's congenital amaurosis,
Okay. So can you just tell what are the ocular associations of retinitis pigmentosa? Ocular associations.
It is associated with myopia, open angle glaucoma, cystoid macular edema, epiretinal membrane, and
something related to cornea.
Keratoconus and keratoglobus sometimes.
It's very important.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And cataracts.
Cataracts actually are the most common.
Most commonly associated. Yes.
So that should come first.
Definitely.
Okay. Can you just tell about the inheritance pattern in retinitis pigmentosa? What are the types?
It can be inherited as an X-linked. Most commonly is the autosomal dominant. It can be autosomal recessive. It can be X-linked also.
Most common is autosomal.
Autosomal dominant.
Most common is sporadic.
So sporadic is actually okay. Go ahead.
Autosomal dominant, autosomal recessive, and X-linked, and
least common is
X-linked.
And which is the most severe form of RP?
X-linked.
Okay. And the least severe?
Autosomal dominant.
Are you sure?
Yes, sir. I think.
Okay. Okay. Autosomal dominant is also one of the least severe ones. Okay. So, can you just tell about the various systemic associations of retinitis pigmentosa which we can get?
Syndromic associations like Usher's syndrome, A beta lipoproteinemia, Lawrence Moon Bardet Biedl syndrome, Refsim's disease,
can you just tell one of the
Kearns-Sayre syndrome also? Kearns-Sayre syndrome is a triad of chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia, pigmentary retinopathy, and cardiac defects. In Usher's syndrome, there is mitochondrial, sir. Yeah, mitochondrial. Yeah.
That's what I was about. Okay. Next.
Yeah. Next, Usher's syndrome is it presents with bilateral sensory neural deafness with late development of speech and I can't remember any other points about it. Okay. Refsim's disease is basically due to phytonic acid accumulation, and it can present with ataxia, deafness, and peripheral neuropathy. A beta lipoproteinemia has acanthocytosis, ataxia, and deafness. And
one more syndrome.
Lawrence Moon Bardet Biedl syndrome. That presents with hypogonadism and pigmentary retinopathy and polydactyly and mental retardation.
So clinical examination is also equally important.
Yes.
In case where there is retinitis pigmentosa, general systemic features.
Yes.
Okay. So, what investigations will you do in this case?
Right now, the patient has presented to me for the first time. So, I would like to get a baseline visual fields, full field electroretinogram. And I'd also like to get a baseline optical coherence tomography, although the macula seems to be normal right now. But just for, so that in subsequent monitoring can be easier. Okay. And apart from that,
Can I put in a question here?
Yes, ma'am, obviously.
Please move.
Priyanka.
Yes, ma'am.
You have said this is a patient of retinitis pigmentosa. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So once you have established the diagnosis, what would you go back and ask the patient again?
I'd like to ask the patient the patient's parents, the history of whether the patient used to stumble upon over objects during nighttime. That can give me a history of rubbing the eyes which is oculodigital syndrome. Any history of, I'd also like to screen the patient's siblings and parents as well, because it is known to be inherited.
Something about parents.
Similar complaints in any of the parents.
You also mentioned a lot of syndromes. So wouldn't you ask them pointers towards, you know, if there is an association with an RP with any of those syndromes? So what would be the common things that you would generally ask?
I mean, any history of imbalance or speech disorders the milestones, the general milestones rule out mental handicap.
Hearing?
Yeah, hearing as well, ma'am. Sorry.
Heart hearing problems? Mm. Whether the patient has hypogonadism. These are small things which give you, you know, the relevance, yes, whether there is a syndrome which is associated with an RP, you know?
Yes.
Okay. And what are the other atypical types of RP that you see?
Atypical RP can be retinitis pigmentosa, sign pigmento, in which the fundus appears normal, but the ERG will be subnormal. Or there can be retinitis punctata albicans, in which there are whitish lesions which are seen instead of the black spicule type of pigmentation which is seen in typical retinitis pigmentosa. There can be sectoral RP, in which only one sector, most commonly the inferior and nasal sector, quadrants are involved. There can be inverses, retinitis pigmentosa inverses, in which macular area is involved most commonly. And there can be uniocular RP also in rare cases. So these are atypical retinitis pigmentosa.
And what about the field changes? How would you say, how would you differentiate the field changes in an RP from a person with open angle glaucoma? You know, how would you say that this is an open angle glaucoma and this is an RP? So tell us something about the field changes.
Yes, ma'am. Field changes in retinitis pigmentosa, initially in the early stages, it may show random mid-peripheral scotomas, which later coalesce to form a ring scotoma. And later it progresses outwards and inwards until it forms a tunnel. It leaves a residual island of vision. That's called as tunnel vision in the later stages in retinitis pigmentosa. In glaucoma, it is enlargement of the blind spot and paracentral scotoma, then sedal scotoma, arcuate scotoma, double arcuate scotoma, and Raine's nasal step. And finally, there'll be a temporal island of vision, which will be spared in the later stages. So tunnel vision is the only common thing at the later stages of both glaucoma and retinitis pigmentosa.
Okay, what is the kind of cataract that you get in a retinitis pigmentosa?
Posterior subcapsular cataract.
Very nice. And you get a lot of floaters in these patients. So what is the reason for the floaters?
Ma'am, because posterior vitreous detachments are earlier and more common. More common in the, with earlier onset. So that gives rise to floaters.
All right. And
3 minutes.
Three minutes remaining.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you get cystoid macular edemas in these patients?
Yes.
Okay. How would you deal with a cystoid macular edema in RP? What would be the best drug for it?
Acetazolamide, carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. So topical or oral, 500 milligrams twice a day, or topical dorzolamide 2% or brinzolamide 1%. Apart from that, triamcinolone intravitreally or anti-VEGF if it's refractory to other treatments.
Do you know anything about Mizuo phenomenon?
Yes, ma'am. It's Mizuo Nakamura phenomenon, which is seen in Oguchi's disease. That's a form of congenital stationary night blindness with fundal changes, in which in the light adapted state, the fundus appears golden brown, whereas in the dark adapted state, it appears darker or normal.
In advanced stages of RP, do you get any characteristic head postures or eye movements, and what would they be?
Eye movements in the later stages? Not really sure, ma'am.
Okay. What about horizontal saccades? Do you think you get horizontal saccades in these patients?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, yes. I do remember. Yes, ma'am. Yes. I'm not really sure about the reason why, but I remember reading it now that you mentioned.
Okay. And what would be the risks of cataract surgery in a RP patient?
Ma'am, there is increased likelihood of zonular weakness, and it's one of another association of RP. So we have to be very careful. We have to first see for phacodonesis. So preoperative evaluation should include that. And if there is zonular weakness, then if we are doing a phacoemulsification, we go with a low flow phaco. So everything has to be low power, low vacuum, and low bottle height as well, low aspiration flow rate. And if it's more than 3 to 6 clock hours of subluxation or zonular weakness, we go with capsular tension rings or capsular tension segments or a Sioni ring. And if it's more than 7 clock hours of subluxation, it's better to go with an intracapsular cataract extraction.
Okay. What about cystoid macular edema? Are the chances higher after a cataract surgery?
Yes, ma'am. They are. So
there your acetylcholamide generally works.
Will help. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Right. I'm through.
Yeah, I think time up also.
Okay.
For her case. One last question. Why is there waxy disc pallor?
It is consecutive optic atrophy actually that occurs in retinitis pigmentosa. It's because it's secondary to reduction in the blood supply of the overall retina.
That's the pallor. But why waxy disc?
I'm not really sure about that, sir.
So that's the homework. Okay. So OSCE, please share the OSCE.
Am I audible?
Sumit, Sumit, you have to announce the, or Ashish, whoever, announce the rotation.
Yes.
So who is going to answer what?
So, I think Sumit sir, if you're you have a network, you can announce.
Yeah. So
if you're not, then I'll.
Then you take over if I'm not audible in between.
Okay.
Sir, what we'll do, we'll divide into 5-5.
Yeah.
Sir, I think Roma is not unmuted, sir.
Just hold on. I'll do that.
Yeah.
So we'll start with RGMC first. So first, I ask you for RGMC.
What is the login name for Roma? It is RO. Acha, okay.
Roma Vakde.
Yeah. So
can you see the case, sir? Oski, first slide.
Yeah.
All the participants, if your voice is okay, then please on your video because it is easier to locate you there.
Okay. So Priyanka, well presented.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank
you.
Well
presented.
Thank you, sir.
So, first 5 OSCEs will be for RGMC. From RGMC, Nisha and Vaidhi will be answering. So, it will be alternate. Okay. So, Nisha, you ready?
What did you say was the marking for the OSCEs? For
ten
each
points. 10 points.
10 points, okay.
Nisha, can you hear us? Nisha, you there?
Yeah, Nisha?
She's mute.
Okay.
Nisha.
Okay. Nisha, please unmute yourself.
Yes,
yeah.
Sir.
Vaidhi, can you hear us?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so we'll go alternate. We'll start with Nisha. Ashish, go ahead.
Yes. Can you see the first slide, Nisha?
We no, can sir. Just see PGYY session, OSCE, RGMC.
I'll share my entire screen.
Case one. I think you have to share the full screen.
Sapnesh sir, can you?
Can you see the screen now, sir?
Yes.
Yes.
So, Nisha, the question is for you. Identify the condition shown in the picture.
It is the inverse hypopyon.
Okay, also known as?
Silicon island.
Okay.
Single word.
Also known as?
Starts with H.
Something like hypopyon.
Yes.
Hyperleon.
Inverse hypopyon.
No, hyperleon.
It's called hyperleon.
So, and the second question, Nisha, for you, properties and complications of silicon oil.
Complications of the silicon oil, like the cataract formation, chronic uveitis, and the glaucoma, blockage of the angle of the anterior chamber, secondary glaucoma.
What are the properties?
Why it comes up and not down?
I don't know.
Okay, next OSCE.
So we can discuss the marks.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So Karabi ma'am, how many marks to be given to us?
Five.
Okay. Why do you are ready with the second? So I will just read out the answer. Okay, it's low specific gravity than matrix, low interfacial tension compared to the glass and air, high viscosity. All these are and high refractive index than matrix. These are all properties of silicon oil which you must know before you go ahead with the exam. Why are you ready? Second slide, Ashish. Yeah. So it's an 8-year-old female who presents with the following clinical picture. Can you identify and mention the ophthalmic association of this so-called syndrome?
Sturge.
Okay, perfect. What are the Sturge Weber's ophthalmic associations?
Choroidal hemangioma.
Choroidal hemangioma, correct. And the second question is, what is the mechanism of glaucoma insipidus? So please, sir, I think Ashish's net is not well. I think we'll have to share the screen. So please, sir.
It's crackling quite a bit.
Yeah. Just hold on.
Why do you think, what is the mechanism of glaucoma?
Generally, they present with some kind of condition around the cornea.
Angle closure could be secondary angle
closure. Common. Answer is basically raised episcleral venous pressure. Okay, in such case.
And also they have developmental anomalies of the iris angle, you know. So both these are contributory to the development of glaucoma.
So 5-5 each, ma'am, for the second one?
No, I would give a 7.5.
Okay. Nisha, you are ready again?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so see this condition, this, along with the OCT of the same lesion. Identify the lesion seen on the conjunctiva.
So it's primary conjunctival melanosis.
Priyanka. I'm going ahead with the lesion.
Hello?
Let her answer. Okay. Now that she has given it.
Hello?
Answer.
Yeah. So I cannot. Hello? So there's some issue with the... Hello?
We can hear you.
Yes, sir. So shall I go ahead?
Yes, please.
Yeah, so I'm not really sure, but is this a primary conjunctival melanosis? Benign conjunctival melanosis. And mentioned three other pigmented lesions. I'm not really sure, sir. Benign melanosis of the conjunctiva.
Lesions of the conjunctiva. Most common. What is a malignant one?
Conjunctival melanoma.
And what are the benign forms?
Okay, Sumit, give out the answer.
Yeah, so this is basically a conjunctival nevus. Okay, this is very much benign, most common condition. And the OCT here is showing cyst. Okay, that is very classical feature where you differentiate nevus from the other conditions. And three other, you already answered acquired melanosis, nevus, malignant melanoma, and racial melanosis, complexion of suspected melanosis. These are very common lesions. Ma'am, you did not answer both, I suppose.
Hello?
Yeah, ma'am, she did not answer both the questions.
Yeah, so...
No marks?
Yeah. No, we'll give her 2.5. She answered part of the conjunctival lesions.
Ruma, there is some disturbance at your end.
So I can hear you.
No, use your headphones because that is causing you a lot of disturbance in the meeting. Try to use your headphones. Okay.
Hi, sir, but it's okay.
It's okay.
Sir, next question should go to
you. only decide now that because she had given out the answer. That
fine. So I will take the name and then only those people answer. Nisha, you're there? Nisha? Nisha?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Please be around. Okay. So this question is for you. Identify the lesion shown in the picture.
This is the fluorescein stain. It is seen in the
lesion is okay. So why do you want to try this? Why do So what is this condition in periphery? There is some stain of the fluorescein that has been shown.
This margin.
Yeah, margin. What happens at the margin? What kind of keratitis?
It's marginal. It is because of staph.
No.
Arterial marginal lesion.
No. Okay. So this is basically a PUK, peripheral ulcerative keratitis. Okay, and it has many systemic associations, so that's what the second question was about. So they could not recognize Rohit sir. So next question goes to Vaidehi again. Vaidehi, you're there?
Yeah.
Ashish, next please. Sapne sir, next. Okay, you see a fundus picture here. Diagnose the condition that has been shown and etiological factors for same.
So branch retinal vein occlusion.
Perfect, perfect. Temporal branch retinal vein occlusion and etiological factors for same.
Ready, talk loudly.
Hypertension, then dyslipidemias. Any hypercoagulable states of the patient.
Everything correct. You can add a glaucoma also. Even that is a risk factor sometimes. Can you say something about Bravo study?
No.
Anyone in the Priyanka, Roma, anyone want to attempt Bravo study?
You can raise your hand. If you want to answer.
Not sure, sir.
Okay, let's move on to the next question.
Vaidehi, when you give the diagnosis of this patient, you have to mention as a VRVO with a resultant cystoid macular edema. Okay, don't forget that because that is an important part of the diagnosis. Okay.
Bravo study, sir, can I just...
go ahead.
Yes. Basically, a branch retinal vein occlusion study. It was a comparative trial in which ranibizumab was given to the patients with BRV with macular edema, and three subgroups were made, where 0.5, 0.3 milligram of ranibizumab, and one was a control was given, and they found that along with the ranibizumab 0.5, the improvement is maximum. So we'll go to the... now... sir, she answered half. Ma'am, she answered half. Can we give her 5?
We can give her 5.
Yeah. So this is the last slide for the RGMC now. Nisha, you ready?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir, next slide, please. Identify the pathology and state the pathogenesis for the appearance that is shown.
This is the fundus picture showing the irregular disc margin. And there is a
something at macula looking at you.
Yes, sir. Looking at you.
Actually, I can't hear. Hello.
Something at the macula we are seeing.
Yes, sir. There is a partial thickness macular.
Something that we. Put it on a cake.
Nisha, this is a spot diagnosis. Spot, just look at the macula and think what it is.
It is the macular telangiectasia.
one of the emergencies in ophthalmology.
Okay.
Anyone? Can we pass it to somebody?
Yeah. Where do you want to try this?
The cherry red spot at the macula, a central retinal artery occlusion with ciliary retinal artery involved. The other causes could be any metabolic disorder, Niemann-Pick, Fabry syndrome, any drugs, methanol, or all that can cause it. And
That's fair enough, I think. Ma'am, she answered, but she was not asked, so we can't give her marks.
No, there'll be no marks for this.
So with this, the RGMC OSCEs are over. We'll move to the Bombay Hospital. Roma, you are ready?
Yeah, I'll unmute her.
Yes, sir.
So Vedi will do an ophthalmic doctor for this.
Okay. So Roma, the question is for you. Identify the instrument shown and tell us the uses of the same.
Oh, I can't tell. I don't know.
Okay. Priyanka, you want to take this?
Yes. So this is a Maddox wing and it's used for detection and measurement of cyclotropias.
Correct. So that is correct. You can measure heterophorias and even dissociate eye for the near fixation.
Yes.
Answer is correct, but it was not asked to you, so we can't give you marks. It's okay, ma'am?
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Next slide.
Priyanka, next is for you.
Okay.
Identify the test and mention the other test for the stereopsis. So what is this test called?
So this is the Titmus fly test.
Correct.
Yeah, and mention other types, other tests for stereopsis are Lang's test, random dot test, Frisbee's test, and a pencil test, which is a bedside test that can be done. And grades of binocular vision are simultaneous perception, fusion, and stereopsis.
Very good. 10 marks.
Out of 10, yes. Roma, next is for you. You are ready?
Yes, sir.
Identify the modality of investigation that has been used in diagnosis here with the picture.
So, is this fundus and fluorescent angiography?
Better version of that.
Something newer?
Something latest.
No, I don't know.
Don't give up so soon. Think about it. Something which is latest. You are
latest.
On the right.
Absolutely latest.
So not.
Okay, Priyanka, you want to try?
This is an OCT angiography, optical coherence tomography angiography, and the diagnosis. I'm not really sure, but choroidal neovascular membrane.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anchor studies, sir, I really don't know.
Okay. Sumit, I think in the view of time, we will just move on to the next slide.
Yeah, fine, sir. Then should we give her ma? No.
Anchor study is a comparison of ranibizumab with PDT, which they had done.
Okay, so we'll give her no marks, ma'am, because it was asked to do.
No, we can't give.
Okay. So, Priyanka, this is for you, the last question. There is a drug shown, can you see?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so tell us the mechanism of action and the receptors affected with this drug.
Atropine is an anti-muscarinic drug, and the receptors are M3, muscarinic receptors, which are mainly inhibited. It's an antagonist of muscarinic antagonist and uses in ophthalmology are it can be used in acute anterior uveitis. It is used in children refraction assessment before pre-refraction apart from that
nothing used in children low dose
ATOM study.
Atom study. Latest.
Latest.
Ma'am, I know. Myopia for.
Correct.
Very good.
Yeah, for myopia and fourth use. It is used to break synechiae, posterior synechiae.
Very good.
Any type of glaucoma, do you use it in?
Sorry, sir?
Any type of glaucoma, do you use it in?
Drug-induced glaucoma, we can use it in. Angle closure, drug-induced angle closure glaucoma.
Better.
Neovascular glaucoma.
Something called pupillary block. Something called aqueous midriction or malignant glaucoma. Atropine.
Yes. Ciliary block glaucoma.
Yeah, but she answered. Ma'am, full marks for her.
Ten. Give her ten.
Given.
Okay.
So that ends the OSCE, sir.
So thank you everyone for joining in. Madam, thank you.
Thank you.
You're most welcome. Sir. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
It's good.
Thank you. Thank you, Karubi, ma'am.
Thank you, Rohit.
Thank you.
Nice being with you all.
Thank you, Karubi, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
Thank you all.
Bye, Sumit. Bye, everyone.
Madam, as a past president, I hope this activity is good enough.
Hey, you're doing fantastic, man. So the thing is that you have two days CMEs, which is like mind-boggling.
The PG attendance is very stable. It used to be 100-110 for didactic lectures. And even for these exams, it's consistently been above 50, in spite of half the people being on COVID duty.
No, they are good. And you know, the thing is that it helps them also quite a bit, you know.
True.
So you all are doing a fantastic job, you and Pritam, and keep it up.
Thank you. Sumit and Ashish, again, thank you so much.
Sumit, Ashish.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Participants.
Yeah. Dr. Rohit, thank you for joining.
Thank you, Swapnil, sir.
All the best. Bye.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Sumit. Thank you.
Stay safe.
17.5 and Bombay Hospital 22.5.
Oh, well done. Great.
Okay.
Yeah, I think
congratulations.
Yeah, I think Priyanka is the man of the match.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
She's a woman of the match.
No, but you know, the thing is that in this it is man only, because in every woman there's a man.
Yes. Very true, ma'am.
Okay, bye-bye. All the best.
Thank you,
ma'am. Thank you, sir. Bye.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Good night.